So now we jump into the next section, which is on sustainability linked bonds. And we sort of pose the question whether they're a new format for the shipping sector. We'll have two presenters speaking. After that, we then have the fireside chat with two expert inputs on really how this whole day has looked and sort of broader reflections. So maybe with that said, I can invite Lili Hocke from Sustainalytics to join us. Hello, Lili.
Hi. Good morning. Good afternoon, everybody.
Thank you for joining us. I'll leave the floor to you.
Great. Thanks, Jacob. Hi, everybody. As Jacob mentioned, I'm Lili Hocke from Sustainalytics. We are an external review provider. And depending on how you count, we also claim to be the largest. So we use here the environmental finance calculation, which looks at the number of green social sustainability bonds issued. We are also the largest CBI verifier and have a global presence. But having said that, I actually want to dive directly into the content. And as we are talking about sustainability linked bonds, and since it is a relatively new instrument, I do want to do a very tiny recap to make sure everybody is on the same line. So what are sustainability linked bonds? Sustainability linked bonds are forward-looking performance instruments. And the key part of that is that the structure or financial characteristics of that bond are linked to achieving predefined sustainability targets. Other than for the use of proceeds, the proceeds here can be used for general purposes. So that really means a key difference as to how the proceeds potentially are spent in comparison to the sessions that we heard before. And ICMA released the sustainability linked bond principles in June 2020. And you can see on the right side of the slide, you can see the five core components of these principles. I won't go in the next slide into the details for all of them. I quickly want to mention what they are about. So obviously we have the first core component that speaks about the key performance indicators on which the target is then measured, right? To be material, relevant, and have a consistent methodology. Second core component speaks about that the targets should be ambitious. Third core component speaks about what I've just mentioned, that really the structural or financial characteristics of the bond are linked to a predefined target. And that could be, obviously, that could be adjusting the coupon rate, but it could also be other structural characteristics. And then it demands reporting in terms of annually being transparent around the KPI performance and a commitment on verifying the targets as well as the KPI performance annually. Having said that, I want to dive into the first two parts, as I think the most relevant. The first one, the selection of the key performance indicators. And what I've outlined here on this slide is actually how Sustainalytics looks at the KPIs and the strengths of the KPI. Now you can see that we have put it into two buckets, and obviously that very much aligns us to what the principles are asking. So we first of all look at the material and relevance of that indicator. And when we look at materiality, obviously there are lots of sustainability issues that can be relevant for a certain sector. So also for the shipping sector, obviously carbon emissions is a huge one, but there are also, let's say, things like occupational health and safety, effluents and wastes. So we do look, first of all, is it a material issue? But then we do also take into consideration, is there a glaring other material issue that may not be addressed through the KPIs chosen? So just to give you an example here, a KPI that addresses occupational health and safety, while it is material, obviously, let's say one of the key issues that the shipping sector needs to address are carbon emissions. So that would feed into our evaluation of the strengths of the KPI. The other part that we are looking at is the portion of impact that is addressed through the KPI. So here we are looking at, if you have chosen carbon emissions, do you include your entire fleet or do you include just a certain portion of your fleet in that KPI? Moving on to the second bucket, the KPI characteristics. These are more, let's say, broader, let's say, strengths of the KPI. So that means whether the KPI is clear and consistent in the methodology. So obviously, let's say, it needs to be verifiable from the outset. So there needs to be clear definition and a methodology on how you're calculating that. We also look at whether you are using an externally recognized method. So for the shipping sector, if we look at carbon, for example, obviously something that has already been addressed a tiny bit before, the annual efficiency ratio or the energy efficiency operational index, both are methods that are well recognized how to calculate. Obviously, the one is a bit more precise than the other, but here we do recognize that these are methods that are externally recognized and consistent. We also look at whether the KPI can be benchmarked to external contextual benchmarks. Now, this may not be applicable for every KPI, and therefore we are explicitly saying here if applicable, because contextual benchmarks really look at does something stay within the system boundaries. So in terms of carbon emission or greenhouse gas emissions, we are talking about is it really staying within the boundaries of our global, let's say, climate system, that we are not reaching a tipping point to the extent that the system will change, that we cannot actually revert that. So obviously for carbon emissions, that is a really important part to look at. Is that comparable, the method that is used, is that comparable to low carbon trajectories? One other aspect that we are looking at is whether the KPI actually provides a direct measurement of performance. So obviously there are a lot of indicators that you can choose, even if you are focusing on carbon emissions itself. So what indicators could, for example, be more input indicators? So for example, expenditures that are going into energy efficiency measures. This is a very indirect way of measuring your actual performance, whereas then measures that speak about your either total carbon emissions or intensity of carbon emission really gives a good indication as to where is the company actually at in terms of sustainability performance. We are evaluating the strengths of the KPI here based on a scale from not aligned to very strong. And you can find a similar scheme actually for also how we evaluate the ambitiousness of targets. So obviously, the ambitiousness of targets speaks to core component number 2 of the principles. And you can see on the right side a similar scheme as you have seen before for the KPI strength. So going from not aligned to highly ambitious for the targets. And to evaluate the ambitiousness of the sustainability performance targets, we are using, as recommended by also the principles, 3 types of comparisons. So the first one is obviously the historical performance, so comparing as to the trend from the historical performance of the KPI. Peer comparison, where does that company stand in terms of performance, but also targets compared to its peers. And then benchmarked against science. That really means looking at, does the issuer stay within the system boundaries with its target? Looking at the first one, the historical performance, an improvement in, let's say, or relative to the historical performance trends is really a base requirement. This is a forward-looking sustainability improvement instrument. So here that is really for us a base requirement. Obviously, there are exceptions, and that can be if a KPI is speaking about being top in class, right? So then remaining there may actually be associated with quite ambitious efforts. I want to jump from the first one immediately to the third one, because that is a key comparison for us, really, when we are talking about sustainability, to see, is really the ambition that the issuer has put out here, is that aligned with system boundaries? And yeah, Tristan already alluded to staying below 2 degree scenario, staying like within 2 degree scenario, staying within 1.5 degree scenario. So yeah, we are really looking at these kind of nuances as to what trajectory is the issuer exactly aligning to in terms of its targets. And there we are referring also when it comes to the shipping sector and the carbon emissions in the shipping sector, we are referring to the CBI trajectories, but also the Transition Pathway Initiative. So that is the ideal one. Obviously, let's say we won't always have the chance to benchmark it. So peer comparison also comes in as an additional reference point for those KPIs that don't lend themselves well to be benchmarked against science. And obviously for the shipping industry, that shouldn't be such a problem, as we're really hoping that that the main focus is here on carbon. But it can, for example, be if we are talking about occupational health and safety, that obviously, benchmarking against science becomes a bit more difficult. So a peer comparison here is taken then as an additional reference point to assess the ambitiousness. It is also used as an additional factor when we considering really the highest level of ambition, which is highly ambitious. And that all together then puts a target into one of the four buckets that you can see on the right. Obviously, we are trying here with the methodology to account for different levels of an issuer's status quo while still really remaining in the position that benchmarking against science is a key component when we are talking about the shipping sector. But it also accounts, obviously, for the different types of KPIs chosen, and then it can vary in terms of the comparisons being used. And that leads me actually to the end of my presentation. The next slide you can still find, obviously, if you want to contact us, feel free to reach out. But with that, I hand it over to you, Jacob.
Thank you so much for that, Lili. Very informative and relevant insights on that as well. As you can see, a slightly different approach than the use of proceeds and with the criteria there and the thinking slightly different as well. Obviously, as we discussed and as Tristan commented on as well, this will clearly be one of the interesting developments in the next couple of months and years as to how to reconcile these two different approaches with the same underlying science and projections. So thank you for that. I will ask Gustav from Odfjell to join us as well. Hi, Gustav.
Hi, Jacob.
Well, I will leave the floor to you then.
Okay, well, thank you. Thanks for inviting us to speak today. I hope to share with the audience some experiences from our recent sustainability linked bond. In fact, it's so recent that it's not closing until tomorrow, which I think is it fits well with the market of sustainability financing. That market evolves very fast. But just as a background to those of you who don't know us very well, Odfjell is a leading world chemical tanker and terminal owner and operator. We have a global platform of 91 sophisticated chemical tankers. Most of them are stainless steel, so-called super segregators that can carry anything liquid. Though we have a particular presence in the specialty chemicals market, where we'll find the most difficult and hazardous products to carry safely. We also have 5 tank terminals in key petrochemical hubs for the storing and handling of chemicals. Odfjell is 106 years old, so focus on long-term perspectives and the way we do business. It's in many ways rooted in our DNA. Sustainability is not new to us. We're listed on the Oslo Stock Exchange, and we have 3 bonds issued in the Nordic high yield market. So the bond that we issued last week, it was for 850 million NOK. It's senior unsecured, and it's issued under our sustainability linked finance framework that we established in November last year. The bond is issued at par, and the coupon is 5.75 above NIBOR, and the tenor is 4 years. The sustainability link that comes in at the redemption price. Odfjell, we have committed to an AER trajectory taking us to 50% reduction in carbon intensity on our controlled fleet by 2030 compared with 2008. We have a quite a comprehensive and detailed fleet transition plan demonstrating how we will achieve our target and that plan together with the framework has been reviewed and assessed by DNVGL, who provided a second opinion. And the link back to the link on 30th of June 2024, which is what we call the target observation date, which will be 6-7 months prior to maturity of the bond, our AER performance needs to be within a certain trajectory that we've set. And we also need to demonstrate that we still have a viable and possible fleet transition plan that will take us to our main sustainability performance target, which is the 50% reduction by 2030. And if we fail to meet these criteria, the redemption price increased by 150 bips. So the bonds will be listed on Oslo Stock Exchange and Euronext ESG bond list. DNVGL has provided a second opinion confirming alignment with the ICMA principles and also confirming the credibility of our strategy to achieve the 2030 target. And last but not least, Nordea acted as joint arranger to the bond and also joint sustainability structuring advisor. And I encourage you to reach out to Nordea's DCM desk if you want to learn more about our issue or the sustainability link feature or the marketing process in general. But just to give everyone one highlight from the process, the issue was heavily oversubscribed, and we saw a very good demand from ESG-focused investors. Indeed, approximately 37% of the book is thought to be fully or significantly dependent on the sustainability link. And with shipping being somewhat out of favor with credit investors, and particularly outside of Norway, we believe that was key to ensuring a successful transaction. So over to the real topic of the presentation, what were our key sort of experiences from establishing a sustainability-linked finance framework and issuing a sustainability-linked bond. Well, there are some critical success factors, and the first one I would like to highlight is that this was not just another finance department-driven refinancing. It was a true Odfjell team effort involving nearly all departments, from executive management, represented by our chief sustainability officer, to chartering and operations, ship management, technology department, and finance. And it was made possible because since 2008, we have reduced our emissions per ton mile with more than one third through a combination of technical and operational improvements and fleet renewal. And also because we have recently committed to further emission reductions that go beyond what can be said to be business as usual. And without that history and without the ambitious targets, I don't think the framework would have had the same credibility, to be honest. And our commitment to reduce emission intensity is the foundation, not the framework in itself. And that commitment goes way beyond the finance department. A second key criteria here is the framework itself, obviously. And it's not something that you can buy off the shelf, at least not yet, maybe in a couple of years' time, but certainly not now. The scope, it needs to be considered very carefully, and it needs to fit with the actual commitment and the practicalities of the business. It's not a general document. It's a finance framework. It's aligned with the principles of ICMA, but also the loan, the LMA. So we could issue bonds and loans and other types of securities under framework. So not specific to any single security. It's not a term sheet, but it's pretty close. There's also the matter of the second opinion, as we just heard from Lili at Sustainalytics. We ran the framework process and the second opinion process in parallel, which in hindsight meant that DNV had to change their scope a couple of times as the framework evolved. We started off asking them for pre-issue opinion, but that was important. But also important will be the kind of post-issue verification and opinion on our fleet transition plan. As we realized along the way that would be equally important and appreciated by investors and lenders. Also, the sustainability performance targets and the KPIs to measure performance against the targets are obvious important factors here. When we started work on a sustainability linked financing more than a year ago, actually, we started off thinking that we should commit to three KPIs: one for the environmental, one for the social, one for the governance aspects of our ESG strategy. And we were also looking at external benchmarks to set our targets and measure our performance. However, during the process, we and through discussions with our sustainability advisors, we settled for one target and one KPI. We have very ambitious social and governance targets as part of our overall ESG strategy, but those targets were not deemed to be representing a material improvement to Odfjell. It was rather deemed to maintain a very good status quo. And we also decided to measure our performance against ourselves and not the benchmark. Just going back to the discussion just now and the point that Tristan made about corporate setting their own benchmarks and not aligning with sort of industry thresholds. It's a very interesting topic and a very difficult topic. We decided that we should measure against ourselves. The environment doesn't really care where we rank. What's important is how we, Odfjell, reduce our own footprint and that we can kind of compare apples to apples. When it comes to timing, all I want to say is no surprise. The greatest experience there was that internal deliveries usually take much longer than external deliveries. Overall, it took us about a month from when we started to actually write until we were ready, and another couple of weeks to wrap everything up. And with regards to the pricing mechanism, again, we started off considering an annual margin adjustment that we considered to be the norm in the sustainability loan market, and also earlier SB issues in the investment grade space used that pricing mechanism. However, for a four-year bond and also to ensure a better fit with our fleet transition plan, which has a slightly longer implementation phase, we decided that redemption price adjustment was the best fit. Another consideration we made is that there's an interesting dynamics between investor incentives and the overall aim of the taxonomy and sustainability sustainable financing. Investors in our SLB will receive a premium if we fail to meet that target, so they are in some ways incentivized to see us fail. I'm fairly sure that pricing mechanism will evolve over the next couple of years, and perhaps we will see sort of penalties directed more towards ESG development projects rather than the investors' pockets. Finally, on the right hand side of this page, I've listed a couple of key takeaways and tips and hints, if you like, for future sustainability linked bond issuers like ourselves. First of all, do ensure that you put figures on internal ESG targets and how you achieve them. Everyone can make a promise, but unless you can actually demonstrate how to achieve your targets, they're not very tangible promises. And to use your arrangers ESG teams, use the likes of Jacob and Marco. They are the true industry experts, and they And they're extremely good at finding the right balance between investors, framework, principles, second opinion provider, and not least the term sheet. But keep good ownership of the framework. That's my third kind of key takeaway. It's very efficient to have arrangers hold the pen, but the content needs to fit with the commitment and needs to fit with the way that we Odfjell run our business and plan to achieve our climate targets. And four, keep it simple. One meaning, we certainly found out that one meaningful and easy to understand sustainability performance target is much better than a number of smaller ones, even though the commitment for having several KPIs might appear greater. And finally, engage with investors along the way. Debt capital markets, they play a key role in encouraging companies to act sustainable. And we think that they really can encourage companies like ourselves, but then they also need to invest to invest in these products to show that it's a joint effort. Okay, those were the points that I wanted to make. Jacob, if you or anyone else listening have any questions, feel free to reach out to us or to Nordea's DCM team. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Gustav. I think great to have sort of very sharp on the point reflections on the process and how you would recommend other issuers to think about this as well. I want to invite Lili on just for a minute, just to maybe a question for both of you to opine on. If I sort of boil down both of your presentations into sort of some of the key aspects, I think we can start with KPIs and targets. Obviously, in a sustainability linked bond, that is the core of the discussion in any case. In the case of Odfjell, there was the target on AER numbers, and we've also seen that being referenced by Tristan and others. Is that the golden metric for the shipping industry, or could we think of other metrics to look at, and should we think of other metrics to look at? Maybe Lili, starting with yourself.
Yeah, sure. Happy to go a bit into detail into that. So the AER is indeed, let's say, a good metrics to use. However, what we, and I'm not quite sure whether Tristan explained that in detail, but obviously the energy efficiency operational index does provide a bit more of a precise number, whereas the AER really looks at the ship size and the potential, let's say, emission factor there. The EEOI really looks at what is now the carbon, the real carbon emissions. So while we put both, let's say, equal, they're both recognized methods to measure carbon emissions, obviously the EEOI is a bit more precise in that respect.
Thank you. Gustav, do you want to add a comment to that as well?
Well, I agree. We have reported EEOI for a couple of years in our annual report, but when we went through this exercise, we decided to use AER as as the KPI, because we think it gives an easier to understand measure on carbon intensity, and we also recognize that AER it's probably becoming the industry norm, at least in the capital markets, so yes, I think AER is kind of the preferred KPI and one that will be used the most going forward. We, as I said, we also considered more to have three KPIs: a KPI for the social part and the governance part, but in the end, we AER is probably the one that hits shipping the best. Mm.
Thank you for that, and probably is also a good reflection that there's not one sort of evident truth. There's a number of different ways to look at it, and as Bernard also has touched upon, context obviously is very important as well. So. With that, Gustav, Lili, thank you both of you for your presentations and taking the time to be with us today.